Hi folks, welcome to Freedom Forest. I am in the food forest to start off today because I've got a few things to plant out which I've been meaning to get to for a good couple of weeks. But I wanted to start off this video today by saying thank you so much to everybody who left such lovely comments on our last video on our food forest tour. Honestly, reading the comments is so nice and it really fills us full of happiness because you say such lovely things. So thank you to everybody who commented on that video and for all of our other videos too. So I'm going to plant out all of this beautiful asparagus that we have grown from seed. And then I've also got three salvias that I'm going to dot around the food forest that I have actually grown from cuttings. And I've got a salvia amethyst, which is beautiful, a hot pink salvia, and I think this one is salvia amstad. And then I've also got some more perennial kales that I'm just going to be dotting around too. But if you haven't watched our food forest tour video and you would like a closer look at everything that we've got growing in here at the moment, then do check out that video. So this asparagus is the job that I've been meaning to do for a good couple of weeks. So I'm going to plant this first today to make sure it gets done. And my plan is to plant it all along this fence here because I think it's just going to look lovely how it bounces around. But what I need to do first is go along and just clear some bramble and clear a little bit of space here and there so I can get them all in. So I think actually this nice big patch here is where I'm going to be able to put the bulk of the asparagus, but I will still dot some individual plants wherever I can find spaces. But yeah, it's all the usual suspects for us. Lots of sheep sorrel, lots of bramble and gorse still as well. But there are lots of nice things as well, like lots of self-seeded strawberries or strawberries from runners. And I also spotted these self-seeded echinaceas, which I actually nearly ripped out for a second. Yeah, so I'm just going to go and grab a bag to put all the waste into so I can take it up to the compost, and I'll probably bring some wood chips back down as well to mulch all the plants with. So we do already have some asparagus in the food forest. We've got this crown here, which we transplanted last year from Dan's grandma's garden. And it's just put this one stem up so far, but I have just noticed one more tiny little baby one here today. But hopefully it's not getting choked out by the sorrel. I did clear around that one the other day. And we should have another three crowns down here where the stakes are, but I haven't spotted anything coming through yet, so not sure how well they're doing. They've never been terribly strong plants, so hopefully the new ones that I'm going to plant today will do a lot better for us. So I'd like to get some of the asparagus right up to here as well, but there's going to be a bit more work in getting some of the grass out of this patch just here. It gets a bit clearer there, so I'll see how it goes. I think I'm going to need to go and grab a little fork as well. It's nice now, it's actually cooled off a bit. It's been really hot today. Yeah, so it's just, the sun's going down now, but it's good. Dan's on dinner duty tonight, so it means I can do the late gardening shift tonight. So that is lots of lovely new perennials added to the food forest, and I cannot wait for the asparagus to finally get growing. It's going to be a few years, so that is a bit of an investment plant, but I absolutely love asparagus. And it's a wonder I've actually got this finished before dark today, because I just keep getting distracted by all the beautiful things going on in the food forest right now. There is so much blossom, and then things like this beautiful perennial cornflower, which is just bursting into life everywhere at the moment, and it gives such an amazing display of bright purple. So yeah, we've got lots of it all self-seeded through here. So yeah, really beautiful space to be in right now. One thing that I'm really determined to grow for ourselves is mushrooms. And mushrooms is one of the few fresh products that we still buy in on a regular basis. And whilst the little plastic containers that they nearly always come in are quite useful, especially for us, and especially when we sell some produce, we do recycle them. It's just another industrial process and another part of that product that I'd rather not use. And when you grow mushrooms for yourself, there is so many more options and flavors. So yeah, it's something that we're really excited about. So we have just done another load of mushroom logs, as you can see here. And this is actually the third lot of logs that we've inoculated over the last 18 months, I think. And every time I go through the process, I learn or pick up a different method of doing it, or read something, a different thing that I should have done or should be trying. So hopefully, third time lucky. Our first lot of logs were on oak. These are oak logs. And I think they did dry out too much, so I don't hold out much hope for those, even though mushroom logs do take up to 3 years, I think, to fruit. The second lot of logs we did on birch, and I think they might actually still fruit yet. It was probably only about a year ago that we did those, maybe less. So I'll take you and show you those in a minute, actually. So, but in here today, we have done shiitake, we've done chicken of the woods, just a couple of reishi logs, summer oyster and pearl oyster. And one of the things that I heard this time was that I should store them for the first, I think it was 3 to 6 months, actually in a shed. And that's something I've not done with the other ones before. We've just inoculated them and had them outside in the woodland. So I've tucked them in here. I'm going to put some shade cloth over them. and then keep an eye on them for a little while and see what happens. But if anybody has got any advice on mushroom logs and how best to start them off after inoculating them, please do let us know, because like I said, it's something I seem to do a little bit different every time. And whilst I think it is something I need to be patient with, I'm yet to say we have grown successfully, but fingers crossed, I'm feeling good about these logs. Come on then. So here are all my older mushroom logs, sort of dotted around in a circle. And the ones that are closer are the birch logs, which I did more recently. And the ones that are further over the back here are mostly the oak logs, which have really dried out, and all the bark is actually flaking off those. So yeah, I don't think we'll get anything from those, but these birch ones, I've just been having a little look and they might actually be okay. So what I'm gonna do really soon actually is move all of these better logs to a place where I walk past them every day so I can keep an eye on them. And I'm also going to try putting one end of the log in the ground to help them retain moisture. And where I'm going to move them to is actually a really quite a boggy area anyway, so hopefully that'll be good, and then I can keep a closer eye on what's happening with them. I just actually need Dan to cut through a fallen tree over there so I can get a wheelbarrow up here and get the logs out. Kevin. And I wish the camera could pick up what I'm actually seeing with my eyes right now, because the sun is just hitting this little woodland shade bed here and everything is lighting up and looking beautiful, but I'm not sure if it is going to come out as good on camera. Morning. So today it is big change in the polytunnel, and we're going to do a complete turnaround of this middle bed in here today. So it's finally time to take out all of the salad and herbs, and then we're going to clear off the wood chips, put some fresh compost down. Dan is going to install the drip lines on the middle bed that we haven't yet done in here, and then we're going to replant it with tomatoes and marigolds. So this is actually really quite sad, clearing out all of this beautiful lettuce, because this I planted back in September, mid-September, and it has been feeding us all through the winter right until now, which is the 3rd of May, I think we are today, 3rd or 4th of May, and it has been such an amazing resource for us. So yeah, it's quite sad taking it all out, but what I am actually doing is I'm just twisting the plants out, and then anything that is still good I'm getting a big harvest from. And we're going to be eating a lot of salad over the next few days, I think. Yeah, and then some of the herbs are anything that's good I'll chop up and maybe freeze or dry some. And yeah, so I am going to try and utilize whatever I can in here, and then the rest will all be made into compost. And this one here, I'm tempted, this one's almost flowering, I think I'm tempted to see if I can leave this plant in and let it go to seed and collect my own lettuce seed for the first time. Okay, so that is most of the lettuce harvested, and that should keep us going for a few days. But I'm going to go and take this and put it somewhere cool now to keep it fresher. But hopefully Dan's parents will be coming by to help us out with something tomorrow, so I'll be able to give some salad to them. And we also have a lovely Italian local couple who come by and buy some salad from us, so I think they're going to come this afternoon. So yeah, all good. Okay, so that is everything harvested that we are realistically going to be able to eat in the next couple of days. And I was hoping for a bit more cloud cover today because it is getting really hot in here now. So I'm going to have to get ruthless with all of this and get it all ripped out as fast as I can. Okay, so that is all the salad stripped out, just a couple of plants that we're leaving in that we're going to work around. Now it's on to the next stage of replenishing this bed. So Dan is now fitting the drip line to our freshly composted bed, and if you would like to see more about how we're installing these new drip lines, then check out our recent video, part one of a two-part series about the drip lines which Dan has made already, and part two will be coming out really soon with more details on the system that we're using here this year. Right, so that is all of the tomatoes and French marigolds planted out into this polytunnel. That's 26 tomatoes I've put in here, and they are mostly a heritage variety called Purple Cherokee, which we absolutely love for a really deep flavour and a big juicy tomato. And then I have put a couple of Sun Gold tomatoes in down the bottom, which I've been meaning to try for a while to see if they are as good as the legend Charles Dowden says they are. So yeah, excited to see how they come out. This has been a great day's gardening in the Polytunnel today. Lots of big achievements, which is exactly the kind of days I love here. I hope you've enjoyed seeing what we've been doing at Freedom Forest this week. If you have, please make sure that you click the thumbs up button below this video, because that really helps us and our channel. And we look forward to reading all of your lovely comments and questions that you have for us this week. We'll catch you here again soon, guys. Peace and plants.